All right, welcome everybody to our third session with GeoGebra. Now we're doing some advanced Algebra 1 concepts. Again, sticking with our theme of when work gets repetitive, great opportunity for teachers to have students go through a lab like this and create their own calculator. Again, this strips the process of all that mundane, feeling, and it also helps them understand graphically what's going on. So if I think about what it means to go through the quadratic formula, you have kids memorize that opposite of b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. If they remember that, then it's great. If they don't, then, well, that's too bad. They really don't associate that with what solutions to a quadratic function actually look like. So the first thing we need to do is, again, establish some number values here. So under my input bar, I'm going to type in A equals, and we'll just use 1 for now. B equals, let's type in negative 2. And then C equals, let's do negative 15. Now, these are going to be things that the user can change. And these are really just elements of a quadratic function that determine where that function is going to cross the x-axis. And that's what we're really trying to communicate with our kids here, is where is the intersection of that parabola going to occur with the x-axis. Now, if you're a stickler like me, you really want kids to have some sort of accuracy. So under options, rounding, let's change it to 3 decimal places. Sometimes we can get nasty square roots for answers when we simplify the quadratic formula. It's nice to have as accurate of an answer output as possible. 3 decimal places is normally what I require of my students. The next thing we need to do is actually put this parabola on the screen. And we need to emphasize the x-axis here. So I'm going to type in y equals 0 just to establish a line that's on the y-axis. This isn't going to change. It's just a matter of telling GeoGebra where we want things to intersect later on. The next thing, let's put the parabola on the screen, and we want it to use these values that the user can change. So I'm going to type in f of x equals, and then I'm not going to type in 1x squared. I'm going to type in a times x squared. Plus, we got to use asterisks for multiplication, b times x plus c. And I'm going to go ahead and hit enter. And you can see we've got our parabola showing up, and the solutions, if you're looking ahead, I chose one that was factorable. The solutions of negative 3 and positive 5 are clearly showing as x-intercepts on my screen. All right, well, let's have the user get some flexibility here. So under my slider button, I'm going to go to insert input box. For the caption, I'm just going to put A for now. We're going to adjust that. And I want that to link to number A. Let's do the same thing for B. Link that one to number B. And C, link that to the number C. Now, if I have the user change, maybe we have 2x squared. Well, now we get a much steeper parabola as we would expect when we change the a value. And so this is really nice. This is how the user can customize their graph very easily on their screen. So I'm just going to kind of slide these up here. We're going to make that a little bit easier for the user to kind of deal with later on, make it a little bit more user-friendly. Now, my outputs, my answers, are going to be intersections between that line, it's calling it D, y equals 0, and the function itself. So what I want to do is, under the point menu, instead of new point, I want to choose intersect two objects. And you can see when I hover right here around negative 3, it's intersecting that line that I created and the parabola. Let's go over to 5. I still got intersect being chosen. And you can see it plots point B where those two objects intersect again. Now let's just check and make sure that when I go back to that 2x squared and hit enter, that points A and B are moving along with the parabola. And they are. So now I want to establish, you know, maybe do some color coding here, make it easier for the user to tell where they're inputting their values. I've really got the majority of this thing done. I just need to kind of beautify it. If I right click on A and go to Object Properties, brings up the properties for that slider, or sorry, not slider, input box. And I'm just going to change the length. It's under the Style tab. Change that to 4. And I'm going to do the same thing. Click off to clear it. Right click on B, Object Properties, and change it to 4. Just to make more manageable boxes that aren't taking up so much wasted space on the screen. Change that one to 4 as well. And now let's move these. Into a line, because that's how we're going to see our function. And once I've got these into position, I'm just going to right click and uncheck the show label option. Now these are fixed in their location right now, so we want to be sure that we have them situated where we want on the screen. Now let's make our text box. So we've got, we're going to need an x squared. And it's not automatically doing that. Maybe if I go to LaTeX formula, do x, caret 2, you see now it gives me an x squared. So I'm going to hit OK. And then I can move that text box right after my 1. And maybe let's put a plus sign afterwards. I just double click and it lets me edit the text. Now let's make a new text box that has, let's go back to LaTeX so it matches the font, x plus. Okay. I'm just kind of attaching variables to these input boxes. And we can always go in, and if I have it selected, you can see it gives me an option to go bold with it. I can also change the text to, you know, be bigger if that becomes an issue. And I want to make one more. I want to write, oops, has me putting an input box, and I want to input text. I'm just going to type in, again, under LaTeX, I'm going to type in equals 0. I want to remind the user that we need to have this equation set equal to 0. This is a nice way of doing that. All right, so now they've got their input box, 1x squared plus negative 2x plus negative 15 equals 0. It's really easy for them to tell, you know, where their inputs should go. All right, we've got all the inputs. We've got it actually calculating those intercepts. Now let's have it output the results. So under my input bar, I could go through and type in the quadratic formula and have them pull those values each time. Why don't we actually have them do something a little bit different? We have the graph working and taking these two points out. Why don't we spit those points in as outputs here. So under my text box again, now I'm going to type in solutions and objects. I want it to spit back point A and then type in and point B. All right. And now it's telling me negative 3, 0 and 5, 0. Those are our two solution points. And the students just need to understand that the 0 just means the graph has a height of 0 at this point. The actual answers themselves are negative 3 and 5. And that's another good discussion you can have with your students. Now, one other element of this graph that we want to incorporate is, if I try and use the scroll wheel to zoom in or zoom out, you can see it's moving that text. So right click, let's give it an absolute position on screen. I'm just checking that push pin each time. Now as I zoom in and out, that's working really well. I don't want the users to accidentally click and drag this, so I'm going to right click and fix that object. Yeah, just making it so that the user can really only change what's in those input boxes. All right, the last thing I don't want to show the label of point A and point B. Those points are important, but not naming them. So if I right-click and go to Object Properties, let's maybe make these points green, and let's make them open circles. Let's make them have a point size of 5. That really puts emphasis on where that solution is happening. Again, giving them a graphical understanding about what it means to really have a 0. And then the last thing I'm going to do is change the style. Maybe make that line thickness 5 on the actual parabola itself. So now as the user changed, what if it's like 0.5 x squared? Well, it opens up that parabola as we'd expect, moves the zeros, and changes what the solutions are. Now we've got a very nice quadratic formula solver here. All right, once we have everything set up the way that we want it, and right now it's doing everything that we want it to do. It's taking in x values, it's giving us solutions. We can close that algebra window, and the user can really adjust everything through these input boxes. We're done.